Life is a journey made up of experiences. Some good, some bad, some happy, some sad. We may all be different, but we are connected through the fact that no matter who we are, our stories all have hills and valleys. So tonight, we dedicate this episode to those who look fear in the eye and kill it. Welcome to Sim Soul Sessions. Everybody, and welcome to our show. So tonight in our safe space, we're talking to public speaker, author, entrepreneur, and speak lifer, Krystal Tomlinson, about how she has soared despite her setbacks. But before we talk to her, we're checking in with one of our season three guests, Joanne Williams, the coffee maker, joins us tonight. You can join our conversation as always by using the hashtag SimSoulSessions. And with that, we head to Zoom, where Joanne is hanging out waiting for us. Hi, Jo.
Hi, Sim. How are you?
I am well. How are you?
I am fair to fine.
What does that mean? And partly cloudy in some areas. What's happening?
Yes. Areas are cloudy, but fair to fine.
Yeah.
I'm getting better.
Yeah. Talk to me a little bit about what happened out of the show. You revealed a lot. You talked about a lot of the issues that you had gone through, sexual assault, abuse, neglect. You really spoke a lot of truth that night, and it was a very emotional night for you as well. How did you feel coming out of the program, and what kind of feedback did you get coming out of the program?
Wow, so much. Let me see how quickly I can get this in a nutshell. My family and friends, close friends and strangers walked up to me. Strangers walked up to me saying, thank you. Some people just said, thank you. My family and friends were proud of me. Proud of me being so bold finally, you know. A lot. I felt like I was of use. I felt like I helped somebody.
Wow.
And it was a good feeling. My mom and I have gotten that much closer.
So I'm sorry, Joe. You just kind of bowled me over with the of use thing. So just let me come to terms with that a little bit.
All right, let me stop. I wait for you.
I mean, that's a very powerful statement.
Yes. Yeah, I felt like I was of use. I felt good. I felt that somebody went through what I went through and needed to speak or would like to say something to somebody and don't know how. And I think, all right, let me give you a perfect example. A friend of mine, a lady, called me and said to me, she was in tears, she's older than I am. And it's a lady I really respect and look up to. And she called me crying and she said, I'm talking to you now and I'm cold. She said, you know, I went through something like that. And she said her mother went to her grave. It's a family member who hurt her. And her mother went to her grave without knowing that it happened to her.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I think I'm the first person she told. I cried.
Yeah.
And she's going to know now that I cried.
Yeah.
She's watching.
Yeah, you did a lot of crying on the show. And when your mom came on the screen for Good Vibes, you lost it.
Oh my goodness, yes.
Yeah, because you said you had never heard her say I love you before.
She has, you know, but not like that. And can I tell you that since then, it has just been getting better. We are loving on each other. She came home and spent 9 lovely days with me. She was to come for 10.
Sure.
And because of the fact that she was waiting on her COVID test at the airport. They gave it back to her late. So by the time she missed the flight. So they had her come the next day, and she missed one day, so she couldn't attend. She did 9 days. It was fabulous. We had a lovely time. I was able to tell her to her face what I felt, and she was able to tell me what she felt. And, you know, I apologize for being not the best child all the time. I did, and she apologized for her mistakes, and I apologize for mine, and we vowed to love each other more. And it's just fabulous. My dad now, on the other hand,
yes,
him feel say, I could have printed up his part.
Yeah, you weren't about that night.
Can I tell you? As a result,
yeah,
we are. I'm not. I haven't maliced him, but I've come to realize that the father I'm looking for in him, he's yet to give it to me. We are friends, but I want my father.
Yeah.
And I think until he realizes that, we're at a point where, like I said, I don't malice him, but I'm not in any. I haven't had a conversation with him since. He has messaged me. I might have answered once or twice after the face-off that we had. Yeah.
A work in progress. We'll yes. take it. Friends is a good place to be until you figure out what happens after that. So what's next for you? You spoke here on this court. You said you'd always wanted to do talk therapy. And this was a bit of talk therapy for you. But you had been
Yet.
Yeah, but you'd also been speaking to young girls about some of the issues you went through and doing some sessions. You're looking to do your social work and finish what you started there, Jim.
I haven't finished yet. I'm yet to restart. I'm trying to make arrangements now to restart and finish.
Okay. Yeah. And where are you with you? Because you said you're on a journey and the journey was difficult. You were on your Christian walk and you were good some days and not so great other days. But in a nutshell, if you were to do a high level and look down at Joe, where are you now? Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm okay. Good. I'm okay. The journey continues and I still drop and chip up, brush off myself and keep moving.
Correct. Because that's how it goes, girl. That is how it goes. We love you and we're glad you're part of our alum and our community.
I love you. And I thank you. Thank you, Sim. Wait. Please, give me a couple of seconds. I appreciate you for having me so, so, so much. I thank you for what you do. Girl, I've been a little through my ball. Every time the show come on, something nice with my ball. I said, just like I said when I came on, I'm in a ball. You always have something to tear people's heart and I pull at them heartstrings and knock it up. But thank you. I thank you. Thank you for what you're doing and thank you for allowing me the space to speak. I look forward to speaking some more. I've had change of hearts on some of the topics that we've talked about. I've had a change of heart for various reasons that I'll share with you at some other time, when we talk. But yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Joe. Thank you very much. And thank you for checking in. We will certainly...
Yes, running back to government work right now.
Yes, you do that. We certainly keep in touch. We don't lose touch with any of the folks who come on the show because they become family. It's the truth. And the same will be said of this young lady who we will speak with tonight, Krystal Tomlinson. I'm so excited. My producer, Lori, will tell you, it's a long time. I'm trying to get her in this chair, but there's no time like the right time. And she's here tonight, so we talk to her on the other side. We'll be right back. Krystal, it cannot be possible that you're crying already. What's happening?
I don't know what's wrong with me. Yeah, but I think I'm just feeling the safeness of the space and just, you know, getting ready to be vulnerable. So I hope I set a record of like bawling before you even call me onto the set because I just feel that my truth is welcome here.
Oh.
And that is such a rare thing in life.
Now you're going to make me cry. Yeah.
To be welcome here. Mm-hmm. You know? So, yeah, let's get ready.
Well, I've given you enough tissues.
You have.
So I invited Chris on the show, and your instinct instantly was to say no.
Because, again, you don't know if your truth is safe. And it's not safe with Simone, you know. This story is for everybody in this community. Guests you've had on before. And persons who are just watching, consuming, seeking to know more about the people who take this seat. And I think I've gotten so sensitive to people misunderstanding me and just being in front of a host or an interviewer who is looking for something salacious, but not necessarily the truth.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just like, oh,
mm-hmm.
maybe no. And I said it to her, I said, I'd love to sit and talk with Simone, you know. But no, I don't know that I'm ready to mm-hmm. have that conversation yet. So it was just the initial walls trying to protect me from having to be vulnerable in a public space.
What made you decide to change your mind?
Well, Simone doing a double take and saying, well, I hear you, you know, Krystal, but I'm going to ask again and let you know what the boundaries are and the type of space that you're entering. And I said, you know, ooh, that a while ago was fair. The no I gave was fair. And am I going to stay with it or find the courage to tell my story
decided to come? Because I've been watching your story as it has unfolded, and I've seen you make some great gains, and I see you take some big leap, and I see you stand up, and I see you just... I mean, when you wrote the book, I remember messaging you, and I said, this book is... Because at the time I was battling, and every day I battle my own fears, Krystal, and I have to push. So when you sent the response, I sent the message back, and I said... Kill that fear.
Yes.
Because I know what that is, right? And I'm glad you're here.
Thank you. Thank you.
A little bit about that book. That book is how old now?
3 years old.
Yeah.
3 years old.
That book was an exercise for you in exercising a lot of things that had come with you from back in the day, from Krystal, the little girl. Who was a deviant in high school?
Oh, yes. I tell people I was a misleader. You could tell I had the quality to lead and to influence, but I chose to use it in some of the most unhealthy ways. So I formed gangs when I was in high school. And
you did not form gangs.
Do I even look like a qualified gang member, much less gang leader? But yeah, that was my choice for a long time, to choose deviance. If everybody is going north, I'm trying to see how many people I can convince to go south. Not because there's anything particularly interesting in south, but can we just not follow the crowd and make the crowd want to follow us instead? So you could tell I had influence and the ability to pull people with me, but there was no purpose and meaning and love and compassion inside of that. It was just using the influence whichever way I felt on any given day or at any of the four high schools that I ended up attending.
My God, because you were kicked out of three?
Well, I did not get kicked. Thankfully, all the teachers and deans of discipline and principals understood the consequence of kicking a bright child out of school. And while they may have been hesitant to do it with me, other children did not get that luxury. If you got kicked out of a school, you automatically landed at a bad school. There was no expulsion on your record that could get you into a good school. And I think that also speaks to the challenge with our education system, that you could actually have good school and bad school.
Mm-hmm.
But they knew I was bright, and they knew I had potential, and they knew for them, she just needed the right environment, man, and the right influence. So move her from here. Because if she gets called up to the principal's office one more time, we're going to have to suspend or expel her. And then you can't get her into a good school.
But that influence that you had and that you were exerting, it's like a paradox, because what you were manifesting at that time was a lack of confidence.
Yes.
So you're leading the gang you're leading a gang. I can't even say it. Okay, you're leading a gang, Krystal, but you have no confidence in yourself?
I have no confidence in myself. And it came from, I think as early as I can remember it, it started when I was in preparatory school. So prep school is preppy, right? My mother worked very hard and was able to afford sending my brother and myself to a preparatory school for me, my last 2 years of primary education. And so I started in grade 5, which is a rough place to start for a kid, because all the cliques have been formed, the friendships, who know who, gone over to who for house, got to swimming together and gymnastics and etc. And here I was, this little skinny kid from Portmore, and I never have no, well, my mother didn't have a car, so I was heading to the bus stop at the end of school every day to go boom my little ride from the transport center home, right? Didn't have the fancy lunch, never get an extra lunch money, so I have to know when I buy, when lunch bell ring, today is a patty day or a bun and cheese day, I cannot have both, right? So to be around children who are able to have both. They did not have to choose. There was no consequence for spending what they had because they could always get a little bit more mm-hmm. or they had extra. And so I started to feel insecure in myself. So I would look and I would say, well, I can only have the chicken patty. I can't have the chicken patty and the cocoa bread because, you know, how I'm going to reach home, I'm going to go into my bus fare. And I remember comparing myself in that way. And what facilitated it was also to see how some of the teachers treated the children who were well off. So either you were considered to be very, very pretty, very, very talented with, you know, the football, the netball, the track and field, or your family was wealthy and had influence. It's like a big name family or a big money family. And so they got warmer smiles. And children can pick that
of
up.
Course,
you know,
they
make a mistake and they get a little more grace and compassion than the not talented, not pretty, or not wealthy children. And so I realized that one of the social consequences for not having much was that you weren't always welcome to the table. And I started to feel insecure. So what I do, Simone, me I make my own table. I want to stay over there so with fun table. Anybody who want a nice fun table, come over here to Krystal. Krystal table nice, yeah? You might have to miss class to sit at my table.
Or end up in jail.
But you know, can't study when you go home, okay. Right? That table here nice. And I carried that from primary school right into high school. Really what I was trying to do was create a table where my truth and my reality felt safe and welcome. So I didn't have to be more than I was. And I think in some respects, it invited me to be less mm-hmm. than I could have been
powerful.
Sitting at that table.
Powerful. Oh, okay. So I feel like you're kind of still doing that, but in a good way.
Right.
So it served you. We'll soon come back. We have more with this lady on the other side. I can't wait. I can't wait. We'll be right back. Back with you, everybody. And we, Krystal has now been joined on set by her brain. Your brain is talking to you.
It is. Yeah. You know, it has a little sidebar sometimes. And it's good because I get to know when the other voice is talking separate from my spirit, you know, whether it's a fear voice and the timidity voice and the don't want to be judged voice. So when I hear it, I can say, all right, come here. Let's reason it out. You know, mm-hmm. they say, you're mad if you answer yourself.
No.
I've been answering myself and
yeah.
I feel pretty sane.
Sane. I'm sane sometimes. Just that first segment allowed you to utter out loud some things that are somewhat revelatory.
Yeah, I had never thought about, you know, creating a table where I felt safe or where others could also feel welcomed and safe to just express and just be without judgment. And I've always been that friend who, I'm not going to judge you. We can talk it through. I'll share with you the advice if you need it. But if tomorrow you get up and you say, I don't want that for myself, I will still love you.
Mm-hmm. But to realize that what you are doing now is the opposite of what you were doing then, because now you use that paradigm for good, for your good and for other people's good. Which works out for you a lot, but sometimes does not. Yeah. See, in your red dress, I think it's so ironic. But what a year and change this has been for you.
I know.
Enough climbing, woolly pot chip up, Chris. Public breakups from organizations, from relationships, and a whole lot of judgment.
It has been, I think, a crescendo almost, because it's not new. So while it was happening, for some reason, it did not feel strange. It just felt like something that was building up, and you could hear the humming, the din of that crowd of people looking on. To you know, you're wiping your finger, getting it clean, and going ready to point. I could sense that for a while coming, and it's one of the reasons that I felt delayed in some sense in taking action, because you just don't want that other headline. And I said to my friends all the time, you know, be careful what you invite me to do or say, because if I'm sharing space with you and having a conversation, I will make the news, not because I want to make the news, but there's somebody looking to kind of pull something out. So sometimes I'm invited to do, you know, YouTube shows, and I have to say, listen, don't ask me anything about mm-hmm. this issue, because mm-hmm. you and I will have a full, rich conversation, and they pull just that out of your show, and you don't get the benefit of the good production you've done. It becomes something salacious and distracting. So I've always been wary of that. And so in the midst of all of the real loss, real pain, real shuffling of the pieces,
you have to be thinking,
can I do this quietly? Do I have permission to do this quietly? And the buzzer went, no, you don't. Mm-hmm. So I had to just kind of face that. But I felt a lot more prepared than I would have felt in 2018, in 2019. Because I've been through the ringer.
Me know.
You know? And I always come out.
What is it about you and the ringer?
You know what I think, Simone, and I own this as just part of the journey. There is a tax that you have to pay to be seen. There's an impact tax. You don't get to walk into people's lives and your voice is heard, your face is seen. They sit on their phone, you're on the timeline, they're at the dinner table, your name comes up, them sitting at work. You're just there and present in their lives. You don't get to have impact and not pay a tax on that. And so I have to remind myself, is it that you're going to stop having impact so you don't have to pay that tax? Mm-hmm. And the answer has always been no. And I think that's why I'm able to get up again and say, how can I serve? Because serving is important, even though somebody out there going to tax me. Oh, she has served, so why she pick that way? That disagreement, I like that. It's wrong. No, boo. That's just one of the taxes I have to pay.
Haven't you ever felt like you just don't want to pay any more tax, though?
I felt that way in November, December of last year. I started to feel that way. And persons in my online community would have seen me travel back and forth very regularly in that last part of the year because I needed to take a breath and I needed to be around my mommy. You know, it's amazing how you want to run back to your mother when things get really difficult. At 18, you go, I'm a woman. I'm out. I'm out of here. Peace. See ya. And then when life gets really hard, you're kind of looking around like, where's mommy?
Oh, I need your mother.
Where's mommy? Mm. So I left and I traveled back home to, to see mommy. Mm-hmm. In New Jersey, mommy, auntie, grandma, and I just got space. Again, a space where my truth felt welcomed.
Yeah.
You know, I would not be judged
to
be at a place where I don't have it all figured out. Like, this piece is actually falling out, mommy. And she
everything is falling apart.
Everything.
This piece is falling out, but everything is also falling apart.
Exactly. And I don't know what to do. Is this okay? Is this normal? Will I survive? Is this bad for my daughter? Because that's also one of the concerns you have as a parent now. You know, when you're not a parent, your failures can't just be for you. Mm-hmm. When you are a parent, you start to wonder, well, what impact does this have on my child? And am I doing something wrong for her? Will I be able to get it right for her? So that judgment of perfect parenting that people want you to aspire towards, I had to replace that now with purposeful parenting. And that meant talking to my mom, you know, mommy, how did you do this as a single mom? Raising two functional children in a world that invites us to dysfunction, you know, how did you do it?
Girl.
And I was able to just kind of unpack all of that with her without feeling like I could wake up tomorrow morning and it's the headline for a newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
You don't always have that. And I knew I would always have that with my mom.
Yeah.
Always.
Yeah. So I want to talk to you about that. This projection. You've been living a lot through other people's lenses.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Did I say that right? So not you have been living, but other people have their own projections of what your life ought to have looked like.
Yes.
So Krystal in politics. Krystal not in politics. Krystal with Moses. Krystal getting pregnant without the ring. Oh! So you say you've always felt like a victim of people's projections and their standards.
Yeah.
And sometimes you just want to get up and say, your standards of me, while I respect them, are not the things that define or dictate my standards for myself.
Exactly. And I've had to say that so many times. You'd think they'd get it by now. But I think they're just as stubborn as I am. So it's just like, who are going to win this? Because I'm going to choose purposefully. I'm going to choose what feels peaceful for me. I'm going to choose what feels like my truth and my power. And if that makes you uncomfortable, that's okay. Because guess what? I don't get a say in your decisions. So you should be okay not getting a say in mine. What I have had to develop, though, is an armor to be able to deal with that because it's going to come. And sometimes the arrows get through the armor, you know. Sometimes it gets through.
Moss.
But overwhelmingly, I feel myself to have a defense and I'm not naked. Yeah. I don't show up naked into the world waiting for the opinions of others to clothe me. I come out fully clothed. I know who I am. I know what I'm standing here to do. I know the purpose behind what I'm doing and saying. And it might not come out perfectly, but the purpose beats perfection for me every single time. It beats it every time. When I stop what I'm doing and I reflect and I go, well, this never worked out so well, but this is a plus. And then to have people around kind of affirming that, to say, when you said that, it touched me and it helped me to make this decision. When you did that, it inspired me and I got up and I did this too. And I said, yeah, man. Yeah. That's the impact I want to have. And I'm okay paying that tax some of the time.
All right. Punto final for this segment. Couldn't have ended it anymore. More with Krystal after this. All right, we are back with Krystal, and boys, she's spewing some gems tonight. Do you have any regrets that you can think of in your life?
I can't think of anything I wish I had not done. I wish I had done some things a little differently. Mm-hmm. And that revolves around like personal relationships with people, like how you communicate what you feel, how you communicate your desires. There was a better way to communicate, but I don't regret communicating, for example. So always looking back, I could have done a little thing better, but I don't regret. Mm-hmm. I don't regret it.
I asked you if you thought politics had damaged your brand.
Well, absolutely, because the brand is something that you build, but you also hand it over to people. You know, you don't get to keep your brand and hold it and say, no, you can't put that on my brand. You can build it. You can do the absolute best you can. But it's public relations, and it invites the public to interpret it and, you know, see where it fits and have an opinion on it. So absolutely, because of how divisive politics is and the kind of hard line that is drawn, there are some people who would have loved to work with me. And they've said it. It's like, oh, gosh, Krystal, I had you for this, you know, but why my boss now go, you know? And I totally get it, that there are consequences, taxes to be paid based on the kind of impact you want to have and how you choose to express that view or the passion. And so I think, there were better ways and better ways to time the execution of it. But I think anybody in the political space can tell you, you never know when the right time is when it comes down to politics. It's just a moment, an opportunity, a window, and you take the best decision you can take in that moment. And mm-hmm. I think I did, and I don't regret it. It's not something I regret.
And best decision in the moment takes me to your making peace with being your best in the moment, doing your best at that time, and to stop putting yourself under the pressure of perfection, whether for your own self-imposed standards or other people's.
Yeah, I have to get comfortable with my best effort. Mm-hmm. And I think I'm much more comfortable with it now than I was before, because I have high standards for myself. I feel blessed that I don't transfer those standards onto people and tell them, oh, you have to be perfect to be in my life in this way. But for myself, I do have a standard that I'm aspiring towards. And in every moment that I have not met it, certainly over the first, my 20s were the hardest year for me, because you transition out of university and you're building this new life for yourself, and you just have your targets, and by this age I'm going to do that, by that age I'm going to do that, and I'm going to do it this way, I'm going to do it this way. And when it's not happening, you start to wonder, well, am I a failure? Had to grab myself out of that perfection spiral at about 20, 27, 28, and say, look here, man, there is no perfect execution of anything in the world, none. Not one. You ask Elaine about her race, if she thought it was a perfect race, she can tell you, say, boy, you know, if I didn't do this a little better, there is never perfect execution. So I had to talk myself down, you know, when that voice comes in to say,
yes,
no,
your brain.
Get it right. To talk myself out of that need to be perfect and just be purposeful.
Yeah, and writing the book helped you to do that. And you did share with me that when you were writing the book, it took you back to your childhood and, as you say, being a deviant child. And I asked you what it was that changed you and took you off that path. And you said it was mommy. Because you, at that time, no, people started to say, Krystal, buddy, yes. Dena Musar.
Something's going on at home. I remember one time the guidance counselor called me and said, is there something happening at home that you would like to talk about? And I was like, Jesus Christ, them think my mother careless. That's exactly what went on in my brain. How my outer road shame my mother know? Because automatically, a child can't just choose to not do the right thing. There must be something around that's going wrong. And I remember when I had finished fifth form, put in my application to go to sixth form at Manchester High School. So I got, you know, all the prerequisites to make it in for one of the subjects. I got the highest in the island. And I was like, oh yeah, going to sixth form. And my mother went into the principal's office, came out with this look of almost being mortified, but it's disappointment, it's anger, and it's a little bit of shame mixed in there because the principal just said, pretty much your daughter is not good enough to join us for sixth form. She does not add real value to the community. She distracts, she disrupts, and she will disrupt people, get her good grades, and then the other people she disrupt, don't do that. And for that reason, you know, we can't accept her. So I want to say publicly, thank you to Mr. Jasper Gabriel. He's the previous president yes. of the JTA. For rejecting me for sixth form. I think it was one of the biggest favors. I've said it to him before. I've been back to Manchester High to share that story as well. I'm grateful for that moment of clarity.
And also grateful to your mom,
yes.
Michelle.
So when I saw mommy and that look, and I'm saying, no, nobody's ever going to tell my mother that because I'm her daughter. You know, she's your daughter, no man, you can't get that. That door is closed mm-hmm. because of your daughter. And I remember saying to myself, watch. Doors are going to open for my mother when she tells people that her daughter is Krystal Tomlinson.
Yes.
And my mother and I jumped into, I think we took a taxi that day from Manchester High to Decatur College, handed in my grades, they accepted me, and I said, new leaf, it's going to be hard, but I'm going to change, and I'm going to use this impact and this influence to do something good. And promise myself, the next time my mother come to school, it must be that I'm collecting an award. She'll come in at the audience, come sit down and clap. And I remember Simone begging, you know, come and get trouble the same way, you know. I have to be begging teachers, don't call my mother. What do you want me to do? I will clean up the staff room. Do you need to clean the bathroom? Don't call my mom. Until I actually won something. And she was invited to school to clap for me. Mm-hmm. And I said, yeah, I'm doing it. And
Would you say to Mommy Michelle if you could say something today?
Thank you for being so compassionate and so kind, for not insisting that things be done your way or the way
well,
you
why
did
don't
it.
You just go on?
Mommy! What the hell?
You were saying.
What? How did she get to
mom? It's okay, Chris.
It's okay, baby. It's okay. Hi.
I thought I was protected from this thing that Simone does. Mommy, thank you for allowing me to figure it out without feeling like I'm being judged, without feeling that I have to do it your way for it to be the right way. Thank you for understanding that I'm a little different from the rest, but I do things from a place of love, and I'm always just willing to learn, and you give me room to learn. Thank you for sacrificing. Thank you for putting us first and you second, and not making us feel as though we held you back or prevented you from having this bright future that you always tell me people had this picture of who you would be until you got pregnant with me. And I'm so grateful that you never, ever made me feel like I stopped you from becoming and I stopped you from achieving or I was some barrier or limitation for you. And I'm grateful for every ounce of sacrifice that has led to me and my brother being here and being well. You did a great job, Mommy. And I am proud of you. Thank you.
Thank you for logging on with us, Mommy Michelle. So appreciate it. Crystal is still surprised.
How did that happen?
Tell me about how you feel when you look at all she's been through and you look at where she is now and you know you think about what you went through with her. How does it feel to sit and watch her just step into her greatness and own all her mistakes and just grow from them?
You know something, Simone? More than anything else, what it does for me is helps me to reflect on me. Because I see a lot of her. I see a lot of me in her. A lot of what I wanted to do, a lot of her mannerisms or attitude, I have in myself. The difference, the main difference is that I am more of an introvert.
So the things that she will, you know, do are things that I would think of doing, prepare myself to do, and then I think about it and I said, you know what, for the greater good, let me not do it. So I don't judge her harshly for doing things that she does that people may feel are unacceptable. Because the major difference is that I sit more back, listen, think more about it, put more thought into it, and by the time I finish processing it, I probably move on to something else and say, nah, that would not have been worth it.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't jump on her for stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
I do jump on her for some things, yes. You know, because she kept me on my toes. She listen, she kept me fit. I had to keep moving. I was jumping from high school to high school. I had to keep moving.
Mm-hmm.
If I had sat down for a moment, in my mind, I would have lost her. And even when she became a teenager, when she was a young adult, I was still thinking, no, I need to do this thing or I'm going to lose my daughter. I need to keep moving. I'm still moving with her.
Yeah.
I still keep going. You know, I'm still here.
Yeah.
And I'm always going to be here. I own my responsibility where it concerns my children. They're my children. I brought them here. And as long as we're here, I have that responsibility. They're adults, yes. They have come into their own. I still have my responsibility. I'm not going anywhere.
Mommy, we're so glad you joined. Yes, go ahead. I'll give you 30 seconds more and then we break. Yes.
What helps me more to do that is the fact that they are respectful children. We've had our moments, you know? Things happen, but none of my children have ever addressed me in any other way than mommy.
As it should be.
With all the respect that I can imagine or can I want to get. As
yeah.
old as they get, I never feel disrespected by any child of mine. So
yeah.
I'm always going to be here.
Love that. As old as they get, they're still your children, your kiddos.
They will be.
Kiddos.
Yes.
I don't know if you're body like her, but thank you, mommy. Appreciate you being with us today. I can't wait to. I wish I was a fly on the wall to hear the discussion you have later. God bless you.
We will talk about this on WhatsApp, Mom.
Chris, are you okay? Okay, just take a deep breath. Okay, Lori, go on, because there's more.
Wow.
Run it. Woo. Ready for good vibes.
A proverb that says, a good friend is like a four-leaf clover, hard to find, yet lucky to have. And that's you, Chris. I feel extremely blessed to have you as a friend, somebody I can confide in, somebody who is there for me right through everything, somebody who is honest with me, somebody who helps me to keep going, motivates me. And I want you to know that I am proud of you, proud of the mother that you are to Zia, proud of the woman that you are and the woman that you continue to be. I watch you step into different phases of life, and sometimes the decisions are hard, but you do it with such grace. You know, you don't let anything stop you from becoming the best version of yourself. And I love that about you. I love your drive, your determination, and I want you to know that keep going. You know, keep doing everything that you're doing and keep becoming a better version of yourself.
I am absolutely proud of you and the job that you're doing as a mom, career woman, friend, and patriotic Jamaican. As a mother, you have always said that you want Zia to feel seen, heard, loved and respected, and I think you're doing a pretty good job at that. You're growing Zia into a free and independent thinker that uses her voice, and I admire that. You know, as a career woman, me don't know how you do it, how you're able to juggle so many things and yet still approach each thing with a level of excellence. I admire that you don't let fear, failures and criticism stop you from going hard after your goals.
First off, I'd like to say congratulations on all you've done so far. It's been a joy to watch your progression up until this point. I'm very proud of you. I'm sure everyone else in the family is as well.
So it's time for you to get your roses. Well, you are the rose of our family, kid. So whatever we need to do to keep you blooming, that's what we're gonna do.
I am so proud to be your auntie. I've been watching you from day one. You know, I've been there. I remember the day you were born. And to date, you have been such a positive influence, and you've brought so much joy and happiness to our lives. Even during the darkest and toughest of times, you've always been the one to stand tall, focused, being bold, and stay true to yourself, you know, and I admire that about you. You are the sunflower in my life. You are my sunflower. I am so happy that you're doing well as a mom. Zia is so lucky to have you, and I am always gonna be here for you as your auntie. I'm your number one fan. I am always gonna be a part of your biggest support system, and you know you can always count on me.
Hi, my granddaughter. We always love you. Keep up that good work, and remember, we are always here for you.
I'm so happy that you're in my life. I'm so proud that you are my friend. You are the most inspirational person that I know. You seek to uplift everybody, even though you yourself remain uplifted. I don't know how you do it. You're the best mom. You're the greatest example, I think, in terms of persons who are my age, who are getting things done, doing what they want to do, how they want to do it, and winning. Keep on being successful. I love you. Mwah.
You love Peter Parrish?
I love Peter Parrish.
You love mommy too?
Love you.
I love you, I appreciate you, and I am absolutely proud of you.
I'm just like, oh, did you find my mommy and my... Well, if you find my mommy, you can find my auntie and my uncle. My brain is trying to...
You need to shut your brain off for 2 seconds, girl.
Oh, my God.
Take your roses, my love. Man, you've taken a battering and a bruising, and I don't know if I'd say you have 9 lives, but Chris, you just don't stop. And whether there are people who like you or don't like you, your spirit of I will never die is something that I admire so much about you. And I am grateful for that example that I've used to try and kill fear in my own life. All right, we're going to wrap up the show after this break with Krystal Tomlinson. All righty, welcome back to our show as we wrap things up with Krystal, who's been through quite a bit, hills and valleys, as we say on the show, right? You don't bother?
Yeah.
Anyway, I asked you if you've ever been at a point where you say, God, nope, I cannot do this. And your response to me was reassuring even to me with my own issues in my own life. You said, anything that's too big for you, you delegate it.
Have to give it to God, because if I try to fix it, I'm going to mess it up even worse. And I have to know my limitations. There's a morning prayer that I have that says, you know, I'm trusting you to carry the burdens that my human hands cannot and to solve the problems that my human mind cannot, because I don't see everything and I don't have superhuman strength. I can only do so much and bear so much. Mm-hmm. And so it helps even when I'm working with others on whatever stress they are bearing. It helps to know that there is something greater that can solve it. Even if you can't deal with it, just email it off to whoever you see as your superior and supreme mm-hmm. being. And I have a God list. I have a little part in my planner where I write down things that I give in God list to solve it. I'm not spending one more time thinking about this problem. I'm not talking about it no more. I don't want to see it. I don't want to hear about it until it is solved, because that is God's work to do. And it helps me to not hold myself mm-hmm. to a standard of,
God.
Like I'm not God in that way.
So you delegate up.
Delegate up. And I trust from every bit of evidence I've had in my life from day one to now, I trust that it will work itself out. Even if that problem doesn't get to the resolution I desired, I will survive, surmount, and move beyond it. And that's what I always trust, that I'm going to move beyond it.
So you have a God list. You put all the issues you're challenged with on the God list.
God list.
Yeah.
And write it down.
And then you revisit it in a couple of months.
Yeah, man, like at the end of the year or in 2 months, 3 months, I go back. And sometimes I really do forget that this was an issue for me. And I go back and I say, but look here how this has been solved. But watch how this. And when I was writing it, I had no faith even while I was writing it. You know, I'm saying, I don't know if this is going to really work, you know, but my commitment is to give it to you. So this is yours. See if you can fix it. Sometimes that's how we get it, you know. God gets it like a, see what you can do if you could really do something.
Please. But, I love that. Yeah. I'm going to try that, Krystal.
It helps.
Also, yes. What I'm going to try is your repeating truths exercise. Tell me about that.
So there are some truths that I hold. I revisit them every year to see if I need to remind myself of newer truths. One of the truths I've added recently is that I make good decisions for my daughter. Because in this process of parenting, you start to doubt if you're doing the right thing. And that's something I added about 3 weeks ago. I am a good mother and I make good decisions for my daughter. And I get up every morning and I repeat those truths. The good in me will bring good to me. And in saying that, in hearing myself say it, even if I feel like a lot of evil and wickedness and unkindness is coming to me, I still believe the good in me will bring good to me. Mm-hmm. It turns the whole day around, Simone. Mm-hmm. How I deal with other people, that changes as well. When I'm having moments of, you know, wanting to be angry with other people, they've done something that I think is unfair, betrayed trust, betrayed confidence. I have a loving kindness mantra. May you be well. May you be happy. May you live with ease. Because you must unwell, unhappy, and uncomfortable, they have stressed me out, right? So if you're going to stop stressing me out, may you be well, may you be happy, may you live with ease.
Yeah.
So even in the moment when I want to cuss, I use goodness, you know, wishing good things on you. May my good words bless you mm-hmm. so that you can stop doing that and do something better mm-hmm. to just free me up from the pestilence.
And the armor and the shield that you wear, you said even when you see the weapons forming, you know you're well suited in your armor and your shield. And finally, when you're in the valley, there's a picture you draw.
Yes, of looking for what I can plant. You know, if there's just a little bit of dirt, I could separate here and just plant something. Even if I don't live to see the fruit it bears, let me just drop something good on this soil. And maybe the next person who visits this valley will see it. And that's one of the reasons why I was able to say yes to this interview, because mm-hmm. maybe I can plant something here that somebody will see and just be nourished by and blessed by.
Krystal says when you're in the valley and you know you're going to be in the valley for a while, find something to plant while you're in the valley. Because one day you're going to get out.
Yep.
So what you're leaving there for whomever is going through it next. Girl. Very inspirational to me. I've held on to so much you've said since we spoke and so much that you said tonight. And I will use them, starting with the God list I'm going to write when I leave here. Affirmation time. Let's wrap the show with Krystal. Yea, though we walk through the valley, we acknowledge that there is value in it, but that it takes valor to gain victory. After that valley experience, each of us has to chart our own path, make our own decisions, and accept and own every outcome. We also have to remember that while we have to be decisive in making those decisions, the decisions are not decisive and don't define us. You have to define the experiences out of the decisions you make, remembering that all of them, good and bad, make for great life lessons. Leave it to no one to define things for you, to frame your life, to name your decisions, and to shame you for making them? Mm-mm. What may be the greatest misstep to others could very well be your greatest blessing. So allow others to speculate and to spectate from the sidelines, but know that you are the driver with an able and ever-present co-pilot who who provides a seatbelt when things get bumpy on your journey and gives you the strength when the fuel is low to keep pressing the gas. So tonight we're affirming, my life is my script. I won't allow anybody else to write it. And that is our soul food and our show for this evening. Thank you for watching. Chris, what a blessing to have had you here. Thank you for being here. Thank you for being here. Guys, we're back next week with another story of the power of the human spirit. Until then, every blessing to you, and remember to count your blessings. Good evening.